Hi everyone, thank you so much for spending your Friday evening with us. My name is Anya and I'm one of the organizers of today's event. So by day, I'm a senior here at USC studying computer science and business, but by night, I'm working on my education startup, Key Learning. So we are a text message-based learning tool for refugees to reskill once they resettle here.
Thank you, Anya. Hi, I'm Daniel Drahora. I am the director of new initiatives at the USC Viterbi School of Engineering. I also teach here in this campus, filmmaking, storytelling for innovators and makers, and an innovation course for solving global crisis. I would like to also acknowledge, as this Visions and Voices program acknowledges, that USC was built on the sacred land of the Tongva Nation. We honor the Tongva and all indigenous people, past, present, and future, and their continued survival and contributions to our society. You're gonna get to hear some amazing stories tonight, and this is what this is all about. It's about that old, ancient art of storytelling. You know, in the past, people used to light a fire, people would gather around, and stories were told. Stories are the currency of human connection. Stories are the kind of things that make us understand our lives. They're metaphors for our lives, why the world works the way it does, what's happening, it helps us make sense of the world. And so tonight we're kind of, this is why the setting is this way, a little bit in the dark and light and stories. We're trying to shed light on topics that are really powerful, urgent, and overlooked. So those of you who have decided to come here tonight, this is because you care, but also because we want you to take this light, whatever light is being brought here, and carry it with you. Carry the light of these stories and spread them. That's about power. And it is power. It is a powerful thing, isn't it? Right, Anya? To take a story and make it known. So we're glad that you're here tonight, and we can't wait to hear the stories and to share with you these incredible testimonies of resilience, of survival, of hope in the face of impossible odds. Welcome.
Thank you. And so the way that Dan and I met is I was actually a student in the innovation class he was talking about. So 2 years ago, Dan and I, along with the rest of our class, went to Moria Refugee Camp, which at the time was the largest refugee camp in the world. So a lot of the young people that we met had these incredible goals for the future. They wanted to become fashion designers, entrepreneurs, engineers. But after having spent years in the camp, they could not envision what that future would look like. And that was incredibly heartbreaking to me and my team because we were living out our ideal futures here at USC. So we created a solution. And by being able to work on my startup, we've learned that we as college students can be a part of that solution and don't need to just sit on the sidelines. And I hope that hearing today's conversation will inspire you to move from empathy to action on other social issues that you all are passionate about.
Yeah, so the island that Anya is talking about is actually Lesbos Island, and you'll get to hear a little bit about Lesbos Island from Yusra Mardini tonight. And the reason we went to Lesbos Island was because of Yusra and Sarah Mardini. So this university and the students here heard about the incredible story of Yusra and Sarah, and we decided to do something about it. So we created a course and took students to Lesbos Island in Greece. And in a way, the journey comes full circle because Yusra, for the very first time now, is at USC campus. So welcome, Yusra. Welcome, Crystal. And welcome, Hila. So, yeah, we're incredibly excited to introduce to you tonight. And
Yeah, let's go ahead and get started by introducing our moderator, Hila Azadzoyand. So she is an experienced social entrepreneur dedicated to using the power of technology for social good. As a founding member of the Kieran Open Higher Education startup, she focuses on removing barriers to higher education for refugees through smart digital solutions. To date, Kieran has helped more than 10,000 students worldwide and has operations in Germany, Jordan, and Lebanon. Hila is also well-acclaimed and has been awarded with a Digital Female Leader Award, the MIT Silver Award, and is a TEDx speaker. In 2018, Hila joined ADA as the Global Health Managing Director, where she focuses on increasing access to healthcare for women and children in low and middle income countries by leveraging artificial intelligence. So in summary, Hila is an incredible change maker, and I'm so excited to welcome her onto the stage today. If we could give her a round of applause.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Dan and Anya, for bringing us all here together tonight. And thanks for everybody who joined for this very important conversation. It's an absolute pleasure and honor to be able to moderate the discussion tonight that we'll have. And what we're looking to do is really understand the current situation in Afghanistan. I think the headlines have been around the world. We're looking to also understand what the Taliban takeover really means for Afghan people, for women and girls in particular. And we're also going to look and shed light on the effects and the consequences that conflicts, wars, and any form of persecution has. There's currently more than 82 million refugees around the world. This is the biggest refugee crisis that the world has ever faced. And we're going to look at that and see also how can we make a difference? How can we all walk out of here at the end of this evening and feel we can make a difference? And we have two remarkable speakers here today with us, Crystal Bayat and Yusra Mardini, two young women with incredible stories that have taken a lot of agency advocating for human rights, for refugees, sharing their own powerful stories with the world. And it's an honor to have them both here tonight. I look very much forward to introduce them to you now. And we're going to start with Crystal. Crystal has become worldwide quite known as the first woman to stand up against the Taliban in August when the rapid takeover took place. She fearlessly demonstrated. She was the very first woman to start the women's demonstrations in Afghanistan and continues her advocacy work for women's rights and shedding light on the situation. She holds a degree from Ram Dowlat College in political science. She has done her master's at the United Nations Institute in New Delhi. And she was in the midst of pursuing her PhD when the takeover took place, and she was forced to leave Afghanistan. But see a little bit more. We have a little bit some impressions prepared so you can get a picture yourself.
Last 19 years I'm studying and I'm striving to achieve my goals, but today, unfortunately, all my dreams died. Lots of women wanted to raise their voice, but still they have fear. They couldn't come out of the home. I am raising the voice of million women. A woman can be brave the same like a man. Years and we have lots of changes in our society, and they are taking back all this from us. I haven't seen Taliban in my whole life. It was my first time that I faced with the Taliban. Every Taliban was saying that for only 20 days you guys are free. So I just wanted to use this 20 days and raise my voice. Everyone is scared now, and no one is saying anything bad about Taliban. But I'm not scared of this. If they shoot me, still till the time they shoot, I will strive and I will seek my goals, and I will not let them to deprive me from my fundamental rights.
Please, everybody, give it a round of applause for Crystal Bayat. And Crystal, please come up here and join us. And now on to our next speaker and remarkable guest, Yusra Mardini. She is a Syrian refugee an Olympic swimmer. She had to flee Syria in 2015 and came over to, made it to Europe with her sister together on a dinghy crossing the Mediterranean Sea. And during that crossover, the engine of that dinghy failed, and Yusra and her sister Sarah jumped into the water to make sure the boat stays safe. There were more than 20 people on that boat, among them small children, and they made sure that everybody safely arrived, saving basically their lives. Ever since, she's been part of the refugee Olympic team. She's been competing in 2016 as well as in 2021 and during the Tokyo Games. And she is spending a lot of her time being not just as a professional athlete, but continuously advocating for refugees and making sure that her story is shared and raising the voice on behalf of refugees all over the world. So thank you so much for being here with us tonight, and we'll see a bit more about your work.
We don't share a nation or a language. Each of us has a different story, but there is something we all have in common. We chose to keep our dreams alive. We carried them with us, across oceans and deserts and cities. We brought them together to form a team greater than ourselves. One that defies borders and limits. A team that belongs to everyone. Because the starting line doesn't care who we are, only that we face it together.
And welcoming both of them now on the panel. Thank you so much for both of you being with us tonight. Your stories, both of yours, have captured the hearts of millions of people out there. And I think it's a true honor that we have an opportunity to listen and learn from you both tonight. And I'd like to kick it off, Crystal, with yourself. I think we have all probably in shock witnessed the developments in Afghanistan in August, the rapid takeover of the Taliban. You were actually there. You were living there, going about your life. Please tell us a little bit, what were those days like for you?
August changes were unpredictable and shocking to the people of Afghanistan. I think not for the people of Afghanistan, but all around the world. We never expected that the world countries would leave us alone. We had given enough sacrifice during last 20 years and before that. But unfortunately, it happened to us. What world leaders were giving us hope that they would stay with us, beside us, and support us. So no Afghan was believing that it would happen. At that day, when the Taliban took over entire Afghanistan and they entered Kabul, we were in the office and we just heard the voice and people were shouting that, run away, the Taliban entered to Kabul. All I remember, like, I took my bag and ran away. There was no car and we were just running towards home. When I came to home, at that time, I was just looking from upstairs to see how the people were running, but I waited, like, because the Taliban were claiming that we are changed and we are not doing any violence like they did in 1997. So I waited for a day, and then the chaos overall the Kabul, and no one was daring to come out of their home. Then I decided to talk with Taliban face to face and see how they are changed. Are they differ from their leaders or no? When we had a group on WhatsApp and I shared all the things with my friends and social activists, and I request them to come. But no one was daring to come out and talk with them. So me, on 17th of August, me and seven girls came out, and we were asking for our rights. The reason that I came out of the home and stand against Taliban was because Taliban start removing all the female posters from the city. And that time I decided, no, if I keep silent the way that my mom kept silent in 1997 when she was a doctor and she was working in hospital, and that generation kept silent. And my mom became a housewife for 5-6 years when the Taliban took over in 1997. It was the year that I born. So up to 2001. So all I remember from that time, the bitter story of my mom, what she was telling me, and I don't want to experience again. So when I talk with Taliban and with the soldiers, and when I look at them, I got to know that they are the killer of innocent Afghans. Not Afghans. I believe that everyone remembers the incidents of 11 September in America. 1,000 innocent people died because of the attack. It happened here. It was very difficult, but I believed, like, if they shoot on me, only one crystal would die, and the whole world know that the Taliban are not changed. Because of protecting of the achievements that we had since last 20 years, we have given enough sacrifice, army, any kind of sacrifice we have given. So it was very difficult for all the Afghan women, maybe because when I came out of home, my dad was not allowing me to come outside. And then I say that because my mother was my supporter, that no, it happened to me, and I don't want you to keep silent right now. So at that day we faced violence from Taliban side, and then I came home and post on Facebook that we're gonna celebrate our Independence Day, which is 19 August. Everyone was telling me, Crystal, you're playing with your life. But then I say that we have no option. All I was thinking, like, living under the oppression of Taliban, dying each moment inside of the home, I would prefer to die once. That would be more good to me rather than being at home seeing the violence of Taliban, the oppression of people, the deed of the people in front of us. So on 19th of August, I decided to come. During night, I was shared with my friends, but they couldn't dare to come due to this protest we marched on 17th of August. When I went to city center, we used to celebrate our Independence Day. We came together and we raised the flag over there. But when I went there, I was the first female. No one could dare it, and there was only 10 female. At that time, the Taliban were staring at me and saying that, you're not a good girl. you have to go back. A good girl is the one who are sitting at home, and they're not come out of their home, and they're not taking part in the society. And that time, I got to know that, no. It was not only the soldiers, because the commanders were telling me these things, and they were claiming that under this flag, we have given enough sacrifices. They were claiming we have lots of martyrs during the last 20 years. So when they said like this, I came alive through Facebook, and I asked the girls and women to stand against their right. So what if they shoot on you? Only few would die, but every day, it's very difficult to understand what's going on in Afghanistan with the women and girls.
Thank you, Crystal. That is, take your moment, please, because I know we're talking about, I mean, everybody has seen what has been going on, but when you are there, I think also every Afghan around the world, hearts are bleeding. And so please take your time. And please, if you want to.
So, I'm sorry. At that day, I didn't want to give up. I just wanted to continue. So when they didn't allow us to raise the flag in city center, we wanted to move toward presidential place. When we came during the week, because they wanted to scare us and they were shooting on the air. For the first time, I didn't care. But for the second time, there was a mass group over there. And then I stopped and I think with myself that, fine, if I am going to die and I accept this, but how about those who I asked them to come? Their lives are in danger. So that was the reason that I stopped. Actually, I stopped only the protest and go into raising the flag at that day, but the only option that I had in Kabul, like to talking the on media and telling what's going on in Afghanistan.
I think so that was when, you mentioned to me you went, it was 2 days after the takeover when Crystal, you went out for the first time, right. And you said, I don't want to sit at home, right? You don't want to stay silent. You continued protesting nearly every day, 17th, 19th. I think we've seen the images, Crystal wrapped in the Afghan flag and fearlessly demonstrating. And you touched a little bit upon that, but maybe tell us a bit more, what does that flag mean for you and why was that so important to go out and show that to the world?
That flag is our identity. Under that flag, we have achieved, we had lots of achievements. Under that flag, woman became a minister. Under that under that flag, woman became deputy minister. We under that flag, we could see women in all affairs of the societies, in different spheres of this, they took part. But how we can accept that the flag that during last 20 years, they were trying to deprive women from their rights, from the basic and fundamental rights. Imagine yourself as me, that what would you do? So at that time, I myself call that white flag as a terrorist flag. Because they are against justice, they are against equality, they are against human rights. So what do we call for that?
And Crystal, you decided to take action, right? And at some stage also you spoke to the New York Times and the media because you felt like you need a bigger audience from what you've said to me. And now you've been nearly here for 2 months. There was a point where you had to decide you have to leave. It was getting too dangerous for you. Maybe you can share a little bit more about that and that having to leave, being forced to leave.
Actually, I had the opportunity 2016. Leaving Afghanistan was not an opportunity for me to come out of Afghanistan, but I was forced to leave because I couldn't see any protection in Afghanistan. There wasn't anyone to protect us. Suppose if I stand against them for the human rights, for the woman rights, for education. So there was no power to protect us. And it was the most difficult decision and bitter moment of my life. I can never forget this tragedy that the day I left Afghanistan. You might see through social media and medias that how the people were getting inside of the plane. I remember that day that when those three boys were falling down from the plane. The fact that I was falling with them too, I could feel that pain. I had no option to be, I had two options. If I was in Afghanistan and I would not come out of Afghanistan, I'm sure that I would not be alive today. Because I have lost so many friends of me. So in order to keep this vice, I had to make this hard decision to come out of Afghanistan.
And Crystal, so now it's been 3 months. It's been roughly 3 months since the takeover. And you're probably daily in touch with people that are there. What is the situation now like? 3 months in, the Taliban are ruling. What is the situation like now for the people of Afghanistan?
I think in 3 months, the hardest moments are that time that I'm talking with them. The stories that I'm hearing, not only from Kabul, because we were from minorities of Afghanistan. Minority in Islam, that we are Shia, and minorities from the ethnicity. So which the Talibans are against the minorities too. So whenever I get call from my friends, from the people I know, not only in Kabul, in remote areas, that they are not access to education, to food, the crisis, the humanitarian crisis which is going on in Afghanistan, this is a big tragedy, and I don't know how to describe in words. I know that people who never seen this sense in their life, they can never understand, they just hear. The world doesn't understand, the people of the world doesn't understand the women and girls that as they should. I'm telling a story that I received a call from one of my friends from Ghazni. I belong to Ghazni. It's a province in Afghanistan. She lost her husband during war recently, it might be 3-4 months ago. So she was the only breadwinner of their family. And she was telling me that my kids are starving. We need food. And the Taliban stopped the woman from their job, and girls from education. So if she was the only breadwinner of their family, if suppose there are many families that they, there are many kids that they lost their mother and father during war, the last 20 years that we were fighting with Taliban. Think about the how they should live, how they should survive. It's not only about education. It's not about what the Taliban are showing in social media, that as the Taliban are covering just because of Islam. If we see the real Islam is giving equal opportunity as the Western countries are giving to their women. Islam, suppose if all the issue is only about the appearance of a woman, I am pretty sure me as an Afghan woman, I would accept that. But they are just making false statements. It's not about the appearance. It's about the right to education. It's about the human rights, fundamental rights, rights to freedom of expression. So from education, from humanitarian crisis, from killing, targeting the people who were part of previous government. I received so many calls that, Crystal, you're out of Afghanistan, please help us, our life is in danger, our life is in risk. So this is what's going on in Afghanistan since last 3 months that Taliban took over. And Taliban are not the people to lead in Afghanistan. They have no, and they have no educated generation or the people. They were just carrying weapons on their shoulders and killing innocent people. And they know how to kill very well, but they cannot govern inside of Afghanistan. Now Afghanistan is not Afghanistan of 1997. If it happened to us in 1997, it's okay. That was not like, there wasn't time of technology or globalization. But now, at the time of globalization, at this time, if we see such kind of tragedy in Afghanistan, I think it's shameful for all the world that they are keeping silence. It's not the matter of Afghanistan for the people of Afghanistan. It's the matter of world. It's the matter of the international communities, they are failure because they invested in Afghanistan in order to ensure this equality and human rights in Afghanistan. But they fail. Loss in Afghanistan is loss to the world. Threat in Afghanistan is threat to the world. Because now Afghanistan is becoming the home of tourists. They're nourishing, they're training the tourists to the world.
Crystal, what do you want world leaders and the international community to know and to do?
I personally ask world leaders, imagine Afghan women, Afghan people, and Afghan girls as your family member, and feel that if they could live inside of the Taliban government or regime, give them legitimacy, recognize them. But if they cannot, then please consider them as a human. Feel that what they are going under this crisis, they are suffering each moment. How leaders can feel comfortable and playing this dirty politics to Afghan people, innocent people, who never feel what's freedom.
Crystal, you grew up in a democratic Afghanistan all of your life. You were 4 years old when the Taliban at that time were removed in 2001. Can you tell us a bit more, and for everyone here, what was life like before? And, you know, what are, for more than 20 years, what have especially also the Afghan women and girls been used to? How did you grow up?
When I was 4 years old, the Taliban left Afghanistan, and we were under I grew up under democratic government when the U.S. came inside of Afghanistan. So for me, I never feel like, what's the deprivation from rights to education? For me, I didn't know that because depriving woman from the Arab, what my mother was saying, that her bitter stories that she experienced, but I never feel like I was free. It's okay that we were not allowed to wear Western clothes, but we have all the freedoms, we had all the rights in Afghanistan. So before that, like, I was, when I was 17 years old, at that time I decided to be to take part in politics in Afghanistan and to bring a changes and to shape the future of Afghanistan. I'm sharing one thing. I'm sorry. It's that today I saw the parliament. The Taliban announced their representative. So it was the exact time that Ghazni province had their parliamentary election, and I was preparing for the nomination to be a representative from Ghazni state inside parliament. But unfortunately, everything is gone. I couldn't do it. And now, that feeling that we have, now the woman doesn't have. So they are like birds with broken wings. They cannot fly. They don't hope. They have no hope. All we are here, we are the hope of Afghan people. That we could do something for them.
And Crystal, when we think now, what can each of us, one of us, when later leaving the auditorium, what can each of us do to help? What do you want people to remember when thinking of Afghanistan, and what is something that each of us can do to support?
I think each individual can save Afghan lives. Maybe for us, like right now here, humanitarian crisis is going on in Afghanistan, people are starving from hunger in Afghanistan. So we can help them through the countries which are the neighbor of Afghanistan to give them food. In term of education, we can launch online classes for them, that they don't feel like they're deprived from this rights to education. I know it's hard, but nothing is impossible in this world. We all come together and we can make it possible. If we are the hope, then let's save their lives.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. And lastly, I want to thank the team that helped me and rescued me in Kabul, Professor Dan, Loka. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Crystal, you are now here. What is coming next for you? What are you planning to do?
I'm here physically, but trust me, my heart will be always in Afghanistan, with the people of Afghanistan, with the downtrodden women and girls of Afghanistan. I can never forget the miseries of Afghan women and how they suffer, and each moment I receive calls and messages from them. I want to I want, first of all, as my priorities, because hunger is the big crisis in Afghanistan. I want to help my people in terms of humanitarian aids. I want to work with the human rights organization in order to provide the basic aids for them. And many universities in terms of education, I want to work for the people of Afghanistan. I know that the refugees are here. It's very, me as a refugee, the life is very difficult, you know? It's okay that I'm safe here, life is good here, but my first home is Afghanistan. I never feel like I'm in Afghanistan, and I was comfortable over there. So for the people who are here, I think the US government and European Union are taking care of them. But my concern is about the people who left behind. In terms of humanitarian aids, I will start working with the human organization as well as the people who left behind, and they were part of the previous governments, and they're seeking for the helps. And I can't see those women to be killed by Taliban. I'm trying to rescue their life and take them to the safe zone. So, with the support of all you guys, we will make it possible. I hope to do something for those who left behind. Thank you so much. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you so much, Crystal. Thank you. Yusra, you were forced to leave your home, Syria, in 2015. When you hear Crystal's story, does that remind you of your own story?
Well, first of all, I think you're very brave because, like, it's not even 3 months now and you're talking about it and you're, you know, telling the story in front of people. I think when I arrived to Germany, I obviously, you feel you're a stranger, you are in a completely different country overseas, it's a different culture, different traditions. No one is expecting you to fit in. So how should you feel about it, you know? When I arrived, I was also very young. So I basically didn't really know what to do. And for me, I had sport. And the only thing that I did was to, you know, do my sport, do swimming. And so that made me feel a little bit that I'm home. And I think this is what Crystal is doing. She's an activist. She is always there. She is a voice for the people, for the girls. And this is exactly what she's doing. And this is, you do what you kind of know how to do. And that makes you feel like you're a little bit at home. But yeah, I know the feeling. I think I was a bit younger to acknowledge it in the same way. But obviously, what lots of people don't understand, especially, you know, that lots of people went to Europe, there were this point where it's like, okay, refugees are coming to have this luxury life. And I was like, I was 17, I wasn't even thinking about the luxury life. But sometimes I was going to school, the school was bombed. I had to hide under my desk. Sometimes I went to the pool, I had to go hide somewhere else also in the pool, like in the changing rooms and so on. So it wasn't, to be honest, a life. It's not like someone told me leave the country, but you are living every day in the fear of, okay, if I go out now, will I go back home? I was 16 when the war started. I was very, very young, so I wasn't even thinking about it. I was like, you know, I'll die anywhere because people were in their buildings. And they were still dying. So it's my mom, it's my family who's like always, you know, my kids are outside, will they come back? And at one point we decided to leave. And yeah, but I know how Crystal feels, and she's not the only one. There are lots of refugees around the world. 82 million is not an easy number. So that's why, like, I really respect what you're doing. So thank you for being here.
And when we talk a little bit about that escape, a very, very dangerous journey, people leaving on a dinghy for the promise of a better future at the end of the day, right? That's what it is. What do you want people to know about that? What you would like the audience to know? What would you like the world to know about all those people that are forced to leave?
First of all, I think somehow the image of what a refugee is very wrong in the world. I think I told you earlier about, like, when you are a refugee, like me personally, I became a refugee when I was 17. And I was not educated about it at all. I just thought it's a bad thing. I didn't understand why would anyone leave their country. And then the war started, and then basically I lived in a country, but I was a refugee in my country because my house was destroyed. And then we went from the house to a rental apartment, as example. And then from a rental apartment, the price was higher, so we had to go. And then I started working with the age of 15. My sister worked, my mom worked, my dad left the country, went to Jordan to work, and all of that wasn't enough to bring food on the table for, like, we were five people in the family. So, in general, I just want people to understand that being a refugee does not mean you're not educated. Being a refugee does not mean you come from nothing. One of the most hurtful things that people said to me when I was in Germany or in Europe or whatever, did you have a TV in Syria? I was like, okay, yeah, I did. So there are, like, some really crazy, crazy questions, and I'm like, one thing that I'm always proud about, I'm like always walking around and telling people, you know, Damascus is the oldest capital in the world, educate yourself. But yeah, basically, it's just the idea of the media putting, as example, now, what do you see of Afghanistan in the news? Everything is destroyed, everything is ugly, whatever. But that's not true. I also know that there is a side of the country that is very beautiful. None of us have seen it because we're scared of going there. You know, it's the same for Syria, and it's the same for so many, you know, countries around the world that are facing war. So to me, I've been working since 2016, after I went to the Olympics, on, you know, yes, I'm a refugee, but that doesn't mean that I'm gonna stop doing what I do just because this happened to me. Okay, the story happened to me. I was brave enough to tell so many people around the world to give maybe refugees the courage to talk about it as well. Because maybe I'm talking about my story right now, Crystal is talking about her story, but there are so many refugees that are traumatized, they don't talk about the story, because they're afraid of not being accepted anywhere. And this is unfortunately 50% true. They're not always accepted, they have these bad images. You know, I'm not saying that all refugees around the world are good people. I mean, normal people as well, some of them are good, some of them are bad, but you cannot say, oh, everyone's bad, you know? It's always, this is life. So basically the thing that I want people to know is that we are normal, and we had education, and I was very happy in my country. I mean, it was always sunny, and Germany is always rainy, so that's one thing, yeah.
And you had dreams, you had big dreams. You were a teenage girl with big dreams, but you've been swimming all of your life with that vision, becoming an athlete. And being a refugee, it didn't hold you back from that. You were able to achieve that. You went twice to the Olympics. Please tell us a bit more about that, and how did you achieve that?
So to be honest, I think I was lucky enough to live my dream twice, not only once. And a part of that is maybe it has nothing to do with the refugee. I think I'm way too stubborn. But a part of that. So basically, I started swimming when I was 3 years old. My dad was my coach, so I did not choose to start swimming, obviously. So I started swimming. I was 9 years old, and then I started, like, breaking Syrian records and being always with the national team, and I was, like, the youngest always. What is she doing with us? And I'm like, she's fast, apparently. But, yeah, I, I, um, when I was like, I basically didn't really like swimming at that point. And then when the war started, I basically couldn't swim the same anymore. I was moving with my family from an apartment to an apartment. I had like lots of things to think about other than sport that I shouldn't be thinking about. I was 15, 16, like people my age were partying and, you know, getting to know the world and so on. And I think I had to grow up like a bit earlier than normal teenagers. And basically I left swimming for a whole year because of the war and because of another reason. But I left swimming basically, and a year later of leaving swimming, I saw that my team, they won like basically in a relay in the World Cup or something, and I started crying, and I was like, Mom, I should have been there. And then she's like, yeah, call your dad. If he says yes, then you can go back to swimming. And they both said it's not our responsibility, whatever happens. So I went back to swimming, and after that, I left the country three months later, I think. And when I arrived to Germany, I just said that the only thing that I knew was sport. Mm-hmm. And this is exactly what I did. Basically, I didn't have a pool the first 2 months, so I was just like waking up at six and running for no reason, I don't know. I after that, like, I told this Egyptian translator at the camp, I was like, yeah, I'm a professional swimmer, I was at the World Championships, and I was, the national team and everything. He was like, are you telling the truth? Lots of people said that. I was like, I swear, I am really a professional swimmer, I promise you. And then he contacted a club, like a swimming club, and we went there. And basically the coach, again, it's insulting. It was insulting, but it was kind of cute as well. He was like, did you ever train in the USA or Canada because your technique is really good? And I was like, no, I was in Syria the whole time. Coaches are good too, you know?
Yeah,
so basically that was it. And then afterwards, the whole thing why I got to the Refugee Olympic team is because I didn't have enough money. I needed support, and we couldn't get it even to pay the club. Mm-hmm. And Sven is my ex-coach, and he's basically, he comes up to me and he's like, yeah, there are scholarships like from the ISC and to support refugees. And I was like, okay, fine, that's okay. If that means I'm gonna swim, I'm gonna swim. And after that, there was the creation of the Refugee Olympic team, and then the media went crazy because the IOC announced, oh, there's a swimmer, a Syrian swimmer in Germany, there is a, I don't know, judo player in Brazil. And then like my coach comes up to me and he's like, yeah, you're selected to go to the Olympic Games with the first ever Refugee Olympic team. And then I was like, no, I was like, I'm not going. And
why?
First of all, because I had the wrong picture of what a refugee is. Mm-hmm. Second, I didn't feel like I earned my spot. I was like, there are some people who have been working very hard the year before, or like for years, which I also did, but like, I don't know, a part of me felt like I didn't deserve that spot. Then basically my parents, both of them called me, they weren't in Germany yet when all of this happened. I think they came one month before me going to the Olympic Games, and then my dad was like, listen, if you don't remember how hard you worked, I do remember walking with you the pool back and forth. And then my mom was like, and me coming 2 hours and sitting on that chair just to watch you swim every day and pick you up and then cook for you and everything. And then I realized that, yeah, why not? You know, it has been my dream, and I've been working on it forever. And that was how I went to the Olympic Games.
And Yusra, you mentioned, you know, the Egyptian, the translator at the camp. He said, are you telling the truth? Right? That was his first reaction. And well, the good thing is that about swimming, you can compete, they can put you in a pool and you can show it to everybody. But when you arrive in Germany, also the language is German, as a refugee you lack documents, you were a high school student. So in part, you know, with the focus on swimming, you were able to prove everybody wrong. But when it comes to those other areas, with language, with certificates, the school, how was that like? What did that mean for you?
I think I did prove them wrong in everything, not only swimming.
Of course.
But yeah, basically, it is hard, to be honest. And I know like friends of mine that still struggle until today, even though they've been in the country for almost 5 years. So the thing is that when I arrived to Germany, I was like, I speak English. Why should I speak the language, first of all? Second of all, I did like the 11th grade in Syria. And then after that, they wanted me to do 4 more years of school. Mm-hmm. And then the Olympics happened, and then, you know, there were things that I wanted to do with UNHCR, with just being a refugee and advocating for refugees that kept me from doing school and so on. So I went out and I focused on swimming for almost like 4 years now. But yeah, the thing is, the thing that refugees struggle with most is that they don't feel like they fit in. And unfortunately, they might never fit in their life. And I personally, even with everything that happened in my life, everything that I achieved, as Crystal said, my heart is always in my country. And it hurts that you cannot go back to your country. So unfortunately, also, when I like post on social media that I miss my country or whatever, other Syrians write, remember it the way it was, because it's not like that anymore. So you're like in a country where obviously they opened the door, they welcomed us, so many refugees. It's I also say like I'm going home now when I say I'm going back to Germany, because obviously they opened their heart, their arms for us. Not all of them, but most of them. But yeah, it's something that is very tough, to be honest, because yeah, people, not everyone feel like they fit in, and not everyone can speak about what happened to them. And this is what I always talk, like people are like always fascinated by my story or some other stories, and I say like this is basically nothing of what I heard from the refugees when I go to camps, when I hear other refugees' stories. That's why I'm always like, when you see a refugee, just welcome them. You do not have to label who those are. You do not have to know the whole background and what happened. Just be kind. Talk to them as any other person you meet. But yeah, to be honest, I feel like one of the things that refugees struggle the most with is fitting in and knowing that, okay, other people like me and so on. I think it's easier for teenagers, but as example, my mom and dad. My dad is 50, my mom is 45, and it's really hard for them to fit in again, to start from zero again. And even if you have like your degree or whatever, you have to start again because it's Germany. You have to learn the language. You have to do it all over again. And it might be easier for me, but like for people that are a bit older, it's really, really hard. And as example, also, again, my age, I can go and meet so many people, but my mom didn't have any friends. My dad the same. I mean, they're doing better now, but in general. So yeah, I think what we can do is just be welcoming. If they want to talk about the story and you want to listen, let it be. But if not, just be kind, I guess. Yeah.
I think that's also pretty good takeaway, right? For being kind, being welcoming, being open, but also making sure that all parts of society remain accessible. Swimming was accessible, but also making sure that, like you said, when you don't speak the language, what can you do now? You shouldn't have to wait for 5 years to be able to continue your education. And so you've been swimming in Syria, you've been swimming to also get to Europe, and you continued to swim ever since at the Olympics. What is coming next for you, Yusra? Is it Olympics 2024? Is it?
Tough question. Well, right now I'm in California. I didn't expect being here now. But yeah, basically the thing that I'm sure about is that I want to study next. I'm going to continue to swim, but I don't know if I want to go to the Olympics. We'll see about that. Right now it's a break after the Olympics. So, but yeah, I also, one of my goals is to create my own foundations for refugees, offering the smallest, basically the simplest human rights, education, access to clean water, access to like maybe a building, because obviously until today there are people in the tents, and as Dan and Anya said, there are refugees existing in there are camps existing in the world as Moria. I don't know if anyone heard about it, you should. Basically, refugees live in tents, and I also was in Jordan, and the Zaatari is also one of the biggest camps in the world, and it's just so sad how refugees like get along with everything, and it became okay and became normal. That should not be okay, that you do not have enough water. Like when I was there, the young girls, they were so happy to just like be in class. And this is like the simplest right any human being can get. So yeah, one of my dreams is working on that, working on, I don't know, maybe building buildings around the world that refugees can stay in, other than the tents, to be honest, because this is not a condition that anyone have to live in. And yeah, basically, I also like fashion, I like acting. So yeah, I know, it's very crazy. I go like from left to right, but that's life, I guess, no? Yeah, so I have so many things to do, but basically right now I just wanna swim, I wanna study, and I wanna continue my support for refugees, yeah.
Amazing. Thank you so much. Thank you so much for sharing.
Thank you.
And to both of you, thank you so much for sharing your incredible stories of perseverance, courage, and hope. And now I'd like to open up for the audience to have the opportunity to ask some questions. We have some remarkable speakers here, so I'm sure from what you shared. Yeah, maybe we can... So any questions? I see a few hand raises. Yeah, please, maybe over here. There, right there, there's a lady.
Hi, here is my question. Like, I really want to do something for the Afghanistan women or child. So you talk about giving them food. Are there like any exact process or organization where we can donate that kind of thing, where we can do our part?
Crystal, any NGOs, any humanitarian aid organization, the question, where can people donate to if they want to? Something comes to your mind?
I have my own charity foundation in Afghanistan that I have established in 2019. That we are working to help people and through that organization. So they're working on the ground and for the people. And over all countries that we have connection with them, they are donating money in order to help those people, women and girls.
Fantastic. I think we can make sure we'll get the information out also to everybody here tonight, the name of the organization and the work that you're doing there.
Yeah, the name is Crystal Charity Foundation.
Ah, very straightforward. You can, yeah. I think everybody can Google that. Perfect. Yeah. Any other questions?
This is for both of you. First of all, I admire both of you for your brave and courage to come up here and not only share your story. But my question to both of you is, as you mentioned, Yusra, you would like to continue swimming. And same for you, Crystal. I think as an Arab or woman from the Middle East who has gone through trauma, how do you continue to find that balance between I don't know, like giving to yourself as well as others and finding the courage and the motivation to do more, regardless of whether it's the Western culture, like obstacles or the Middle Eastern obstacles, you know, whether it's from a Taliban, whether it's like the guilt that you have from being here as you watch people suffer back in the Middle East.
Maybe to summarize a little bit the question towards, I think what even there's a term for it, survivor's guilt. You made it out, but your people haven't, right? So I think you talked a little bit about that, Crystal, and Yusra as well, right? You both made it out of a very dangerous situation, but your people haven't. And I think the question is how do you deal with that? How do you feel? How do you deal with that situation and feeling?
First of all, the only thing we can do is to convince the world countries to not recognize Taliban as a legitimate government in the world and not give them power. The first thing that we can do it. I know it's very difficult to think about all of them. It's not only one, two, it's 20 million, and it's not a small number of people. The second thing is that those who are at high risk and left behind of us, we are trying our best to move them to our safe zone. And thirdly, we all can be a help for the people of Afghanistan through social media, make the we can raise awareness to the world. I know that everyone got to know about what's going on in Afghanistan. This is what we can do. I'm concerned about them, that I left them behind, especially like people. Imagine that right now I'm outspoken about Taliban. So the team that they were working with me, because I was the I established a political party by the name of Justice and Equality. So they are all in Afghanistan, and their lives are at high risk. We are trying to rescue them from Kabul to a safe zone. But, you know, with empty hand, it's impossible. We need to raise funds in order to take plane and get them out of Afghanistan. So in this term, I think I need your help. Thank you so much.
Yusra, what about yourself?
Yeah? No. First of all, I don't think you should feel guilty that you made it out. I did for quite a while, to be honest, and it made me just anxious, and it made me feel bad the whole time. And to be honest, the only thing that you can do, as Crystal said, you can try to help as much as possible. I've been telling my story, believe me, I told it basically the past 5 years more than 5,000 times. But I know that telling my story will kind of let the world know that this is still happening. And until today, this is still happening. Again, 82 million refugees around the world. This is not an easy number at all. And also about what you said about like being Middle Eastern and all of that. First of all, unfortunately, I've been raised in a way, you know, the society in the Arabic world is like women belong in the kitchen, or I don't know, those really crazy sentence. Obviously, I didn't grow up in a family like that. Both my mom and my dad. My mom was like always running us after our education. My dad wanted us to be athletes. Even my mom and dad's families were against us being swimmers because, oh, she's wearing a swimming suit. And my dad was like, this is professional. Like, this has nothing to do with the society. If you don't understand, that's your problem. So in my opinion, having the people, the right people around you is very, very important. And also, when you come to the Western world, it's like the complete opposite. also with mental health as well, as example. In Syria, you're just, okay, toughen up, go, because you're just thinking about how to get food, how to just have a normal life, and then you come to, you know, Europe or America, and then it's about, oh, how do you feel? And I'm like, it's tough, and you go from never talking about it to talking about it every day. but yeah, to be honest, just surround yourself with the right people. Know that whatever you do is for yourself, and it does not matter what others think. If you think this is right for you, if you think that this is working, then do it. That's all you have to think about, to be honest. Yeah.
Great, thank you so much. More questions. I see somebody in the back raising their hand. That was a tough one.
Thank you both so much for being here. I think you're both so courageous and your stories are really inspiring. So, like, thank you just for sharing. And I'm talking about courage. Like, what, I'm just curious, like, each day, maybe when you were in your country before you gathered the courage to leave and seek a greater life for yourself or escaping and with your life, like, what is that like when you're in that place and you're finding the courage to move forward and face the impossible? And for yourself and for the people and for your family, like, I'm just trying to get inside of your head and understand, like, what that must be like and how you just forged through, like, insurmountable, you know, kind of adversity.
In terms of the how do you find the strength and the courage to continue, especially when you were forced to leave?
I think because you guys have never been through that condition, so if you face with that kind of danger and risk, you by yourself will get that courage to stand against this. So the next point was about...
That was pretty much the direction, the question. Do you want to continue, Crystal? Or you,
Yusra, I can continue.
To be honest, like, for me, it was crossing, and the whole thing was just trusting my older crazy sister. Like, she basically... I've been copying her my whole life, to be honest. And I learned even English because of her. She was just different since we were really young. And kind of I wanted to be like her. So I did everything she did. And when we decided to leave the country, the only thing that I was 100% sure of is that my sister would do anything for me, no matter what happens. So even when we were on the boat, before getting on the boat, which is crazy, she was like, if anything happens, you leave everyone and swim. I was like, and what about you? And then she was like, no, you just swim. I was like, okay, you're just crazy, and I'm not gonna do that. But yeah, basically, I had an amazing family. They were very different. They believed in us. They told us what's right and what's wrong, and they told us, okay, do whatever you want now. And basically, I have no idea why, but, like, since we were young, we felt like we were different from the society and so on. And I've been just swimming my whole life. I didn't really go out so many times. My dad was a bit strict about swimming. It was basically my whole life. So yeah, I think I learned from my team, from swimming, how to be patient, how to share, because it's crazy swimming. Like, when you go race, you race on your own, but without your team, you're basically no one, or you can't go very further because you need them. And this is kind of how life is. In the end, you decide on your own, but you need people in your life to go further. And this is why I always trusted in my sister, and I went wherever she went. not anymore, but, like, you know, when I was a bit younger.
Like the power of a very strong support network, family, friends, that made support the resilience, right? Building that and honing that. Are there more questions from the... Oh, there are many.
Thank you. What a treat to have you here in Los Angeles, so thank you so much. Thank you, Hila, for moderating tonight. My question has to do with being a child and leaving your country. So in the case of Yusra, like, you mentioned your mom and how, you know, different it was for your mom than it was for you and your siblings. And what could schools do to help in that integration process? That's part of the work I do these days. And, you know, how can we do better so that then the parents also feel that they belong? Thank you.
So I think, first of all, like, at schools or in general, in education, no one mentions refugees around the world. Or, as I said, I was just 17 and I didn't accept being a refugee when I left the country. And I was like, no, I do not want to be called refugee. I came as a refugee, but that's it. And basically, for my parents, what helped them the most is there's like kind of a program in Germany where you can contact something called Job Center, and then there are people who are volunteers, and you kind of you make friends. There's basically one person you contact whenever you need to speak German, as example, or whenever you need something, like, because, yeah, one thing about Germany, you have so many papers, and you have to do lots of paper, and to be honest, until now, I do not understand the mail if I get it, so I always need help. I swear to God, I do not understand.
I was born in Germany, I still don't understand. It's very complicated.
See?
It's bureaucracy.
Yeah. So basically, I think like a program that make them feel included is very important. Like, as example, my mom now, after 5 years, she was a physical therapist, and she didn't get the courage until now. Like now, 6 years later, she decided to, you know, go, even if her German is not perfect. She went to the hospital and is working now, and she was telling me, yeah, they're telling me things, but I don't understand. And I told her, yeah, but this is how I learned everything. Like, when you do the job, as example, swimming, when they tell me what to do, I know the word, kind of, you know. So I think if there's like a really, really small system that they feel supported, that, okay, I don't know, once a week, all of those refugees come together with other citizens, as example, from America, to feel included, to learn something from them. I think that's enough at the beginning, and just to give them courage to go further in life, kind of, because they're always also, they also have the idea in their brain, which is bad. It's like, oh, I'm older, I can't learn. I'm like, that's very wrong. Who, why? That's not true. Basically, like, everyone thinks that, and I'm like, no, there are people who achieved their dreams when they were 60. So, but that's just, nuh-uh. No, yeah.
I think we have two more questions. I see one here, and also in the back there.
Salam Habibti. So I've been following you for years, and I have two questions kind of for both of you, and you can answer if you want. But one is, I wondered if you have an opinion on the term, like, refugee crisis, and if you have any qualms with it. Like, I know personally I hate the wording of it, and I was wondering if maybe you guys had anything to say. And the second was if you could move past the point of being labeled a refugee. You're just somebody who has migrated. What would your dream job be? I know you talked about acting, and then you were pursuing a PhD. I was wondering if you guys wanted to speak more on that.
So maybe just to summarize, I hear a little bit the ambition and the let's say the risk that comes, and what you also mentioned, Yusra, with being labeled at the end of the day, being labeled as something, and that belief that then holds you back, you know. And I think you were asking a little bit what the dream job is. Maybe Yusra, you want to take that?
So basically, the story of how I accepted the wording, like, refugee or being a refugee, I walked into the Olympic stadium, the opening ceremony, And when I entered with the Refugee Olympic team that is so diverse, that is so different, each one of them have a different story, each one of them basically were fighting for their life, their whole life, and some of them were still in a camp, actually, and they still continue to do sport and following their dreams. And when I entered to the stadium, I was basically, to be honest, until I went to the Olympic Games, I didn't accept the word. And when I entered the Olympic Stadium, the whole stadium just stood up for the team. And then I started getting messages from younger people, from everyone on social media, saying, yeah, because of you got the courage to do that, because of you, blah, 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 because of the Refugee Olympic team, like, I have hope that, you know, I'm going to do better in life. And then I was like, this is not about me anymore only. This is about a community. This is about something way, way bigger than me. And if telling my story 1,000 times will help this cause, I will tell it. Yeah, so that's basically, so I did not deal with it. I just accepted who I am. And I am very proud, actually, of everything I've done or every refugee have done. And I hope that they accept the word, and I hope that the world will be a bit more educated about that and about refugees around the world. And as of a dream job, that's actually very, I don't know, to be honest. Basically, I am doing my dream job. Like, I try to give hope to people to do what they love. I don't know if you guys recently watched Cruella. Yeah, that I want to do. I love fashion. And yeah, basically I loved the movie and I was like, okay, I want to be a fashion designer, or I also love acting. So I'll be in Hollywood, basically, 100% sure, but I don't know what I'll be doing. We'll see.
Great, thank you so much. Crystal, do you have any thoughts, comments? Would you like to take also that question?
About my dream job? It's too early to share, but I want to share. Since 2015, when I graduated from school, so at that time I got to know that in a patriarchal society, it's always men who make decision for the woman and assign them rules that you should do like this and this. So since that time, I'm thinking up to now that I'm here to remove this system in Afghanistan. There is no woman, president woman in Afghanistan. There is no prime minister in Afghanistan. So I see Afghan women, all women around the world, enough capable as men are. So I can be, but first of all, let's pray for the people of Afghanistan in order to keep this vice race, and I will work for that. I want to be the change that I want to see in Afghanistan. So I hope that one day we'll have a president woman in Afghanistan. It's not only that I would be, but I'm trying my best.
I think we would all yes. love to see that. I would love to see that, absolutely. I think we have maybe time for one last question, and then I think then, but I see we have many more actually. Yeah, please.
Thank you. Thank you very much for excellent panel, and to three of you, I'm really amazed, and welcome to USC, all three of you, because I'm a professor here. I can welcome you here.
thank you so much.
My pleasure. I have a question for Ms. Crystal and also Ms. Yusra. You both mentioned, and I had this conversation with Ms. Sophia Mahfouz last night, about the term refugees. And I think the term refugees in Farsi or Dari is translated as avare, which is not very good. What I had this conversation because Ms. Mahfouz also mentioned that last night that there has to be a new term, a new branding of that. I have done some studies of that, and one of my mentors has been the late Prince Sadruddin Agha Khan, the High Commissioner for Refugees many years ago, who was a legend. I think this is what I propose to Ms. Mahfouz. There is a new term being used in Iran. It's called panahju. Panahju means literal translation, protection seeker. This is my translation. Or my other translation is support seeker. Don't you think that really this term refugees needs to be changed? Because all of you here, because you are seeking protection from Taliban, you're seeking protection from the war and that. And I'm saying that because now we are talking about the third generation of refugees coming. So far, the two of you, unfortunately, you are considered political refugees. There is also another category called environmental refugees. This environmental refugees or climate refugees, they will come, unfortunately, at a growing rate because of the climate change. And they are also not because of politics, not because of economics, because of the climate. The land will be submerged. They are really after protection. Protection by the world. You are asking the international community to help the Afghan people, to stop the refugees, and to protect Afghan within the country of Afghanistan. What are your thinking? What are some of your thoughts about really rethinking this whole menace, which is called refugees, and rebranding that, and maybe going to the root cause of it?
Thank you. So first of all, I think the problem is not the wording. First of all, this is very important. I think it's, as you said, like, there will unfortunately always be refugees because of wars, because of now climate change, because of so many things that are happening in the world. And the thing that is so important is that countries accept that this is happening. And countries accept that there is no country in the world where it's like, let's say Syria is not full of Syrians only. There are so many cultures, Germany, America, you know, it cannot be one race or whatever that is. So I think when the world accepts that, the change will happen. And I say the world, politics, mostly. Because if you look at what's happening, as example in sometimes Italy or the UK, people were reaching out by sea and they were forced to go back as refugees. They were the boats were shot. There is as example Sea Watch that rescues refugees and everything. My sister was on one of those ships, and they rescued refugees, and then they had to send them back to the country that they came from. So you're forcing a refugee to go back this deadly way that they made to reach to this point, which sometimes take up to 25 days or months crossing. And on the way, obviously, you lose siblings, you lose people you love. So alone, the thought of the refugees existing and then turning them back, I think this is one of the bigger problems than, you know, I didn't feel bad because of the word or because I am a refugee. I felt bad because no one educated me about it, because no one told me that's okay. No one told me that maybe, I don't know, once in your life, a war will happen. I think maybe we should be more educated about that. We should be more educated about being open to having refugees in our countries. We should be also, in general, we should be educated about this cause. And as you said, there's a climate change crisis right now, and we have to expect refugees coming from areas that are affected, of course. So I think the system has to be fixed before the wording, to be honest.
Like a mental shift. We have to shift our mentalities, openness towards refugees, a welcoming culture. And like you said, it can It can happen to anybody. Yeah. Currently, 1% of the world's population is displaced, but you have the climate crisis coming. You have a war can, you know, that is nothing that is far away. That can happen to anybody. And I think just remembering that we're all human. We have much, much more in common than anything that, you know, sets us apart, and keeping that in mind. And to your point of the protection, we seek protection. Everybody wants their families safe, their friends, their loved ones. And I think like the mentality shift of keeping that in mind. Crystal, would you like to also add anything to that question?
I think Yusra said enough, but as we, as the human professor mentioned, that in Persian it's avara or bechara. We call it avara as bechara, so a negative term, which refugee can have the same meaning to that. I think this is the most difficult time when we hear this, that we are refugee here. And what Yusra mentioned that I have experienced since last 3 months that I came here, they think that we didn't have good life in Afghanistan, we have never seen good things in our country, which make you feel bad. You know, I'm tired of hearing refugee, the name of refugee here. So somehow, I know in America is a land that half of the population, most of half of the population is a refugee. So if not this generation, maybe the X generation or previous generation were a refugee due to genocide that happened in their countries, whatever, there was a cause that they came and they saved their life.
So keeping our minds and hearts open is what I'm hearing from you both. Yeah. I think we're coming closely to an end. Thank you so much all for asking questions, engaging, and coming out here tonight to listen to these two incredible and remarkable young speakers sharing their stories. And most importantly also, hopefully going home with, you know, some ideas of what maybe each of you can do, what each of you is taking away from this conversation and keeping in mind. So thank you very much from our end, and thanks so much for your time and coming here. And thanks to both of you so much.
These are phenomenal stories that have reached headlines, that have been or will be turned into stories and documentaries. But I think for every Yusra and every Crystal, there are millions of people out there who are stuck in refugee camps, who will continue to be there, whose education will be short or limited. And I think this is a real problem that society is facing. In Afghanistan, this is not the first crisis. There have been 5 to 6 generations of Afghans who have been refugees. My family is one of them. I was a child refugee. For 8 years, my family was stuck on the borders between Pakistan and Afghanistan. In refugee camps, you can't access education, healthcare. You don't even have the basic fundamentals of just a simple shelter. And so when you look at the reality of what humanity is facing today, it's an epidemic, it's a crisis, a humanitarian crisis. And I think with what we saw in Afghanistan and with Syria, it was a civilian-led response that enabled someone like Crystal to escape the country. And in Yusra's case, there was an army of people, including Luca and Sven and Dan, who were helping. So this is a time that is really exciting. I think there's a lot of hope. Any one of us could be the response. We do not need to wait for the United States to be the response. We do not need to wait for United Nations to take the first step. The stories that have been shared today and the organizations and the civilians who have worked tirelessly the last 2.5 months in both Afghanistan and in Syria and in Greece to support refugees is extraordinary. Those are silent ninjas behind every refugee story who has helped, who has lifted and uplifted and provided emotional and mental support. And I would just love to invite you to be part of that community is the most incredible thing that I've been part of. I've been incredibly blessed to be working with John, Dan, Luca, Anya, and Autumn, and everyone here. And I want to take a moment to thank USC and Vision and Voices for giving us the opportunity to share these extraordinary stories, to share the work that we're hoping to do. I think we're in a really exciting time to disrupt humanitarian aid. Every other industry has been disrupted by technology except for the space. So there's a lot of students here. I'd love to invite you to use the resources that you have, to use technology, and to really think creatively about ways that these problems can be solved. We founded Afghan Innovation Foundation as a response to this crisis, and we are doing work to bring innovation to the space. In ways that you can help, we are fundraising to continue our efforts with evacuation. We are fundraising to change policy. I think that, as everyone mentioned here, there's a short-term crisis that's taking place, and then there's a longer-term crisis. The international world is not prepared to deal with mass migration and displacement, and I think it's really important that we find creative solutions. We are not prepared to handle this crisis, and we need to find technological solutions, creative system-level solutions, as well as policy implementation in order to tackle this. So I'd love for you to join. Feel free to click on this QR code. We need volunteers who can help with operations, with campaigning, with advocacy work, as well as extraordinary people who can open their hearts, minds, and souls, and their pockets to help contribute to the efforts. Thank you so much.